Thank you. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Dear brothers and sisters, dear audience, viewers on the internet, I would like to say that thank you very much for coming and thank you for showing a support to this fatwa. It's not an easy issue that we are discussing tonight. It's very complicated, and there are a lot of involvement of different meanings that people, scholars, are worried and afraid to stand up or to go forward to put such something like that. I would recall that one of the biggest imam of Muslims, who is Imam Malik, came after the time of Prophet, peace be upon him, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he had 300 teachers at that time in Sharia, in Islamic law. And he was always worried to put a fatwa, because you be responsible in front of our Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our God, and you will be responsible in, from the community about what you have done. So rarely he put a fatwa. Sayyidina Umar, the second Khalifa of Prophet, the Caliphate, the time of the Caliphate after Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, refused many times to give a fatwa. So what we did here, it was more than that. We worked on it 2 years ago, and many times they asked me to publish it. I said no, because I was reluctant, because it is an issue between in the Muslim countries. And we work, I would say that I will thank Dr. Mateen Siddiqui, he was sitting here, that he worked with me on it, Dr. Humaira and Dr. Hadia, that worked on this project. So 2 years ago I said no, we will not put it out, because it's very technical. And if someone is not really understand well Islamic law or Islamic jurisprudence or Islamic explanations, it will be a little bit difficult for understanding the different analysis that you have put inside this fatwa. But in any case, we understand in Islam that the Holy Quran is the book of God that he has sent to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And also we believe that Jesus Christ has received the Bible as sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Lord. And we believe that the Torah has been received by Sayyidina Musa, by Moses, as it has been sent to him. So Jewish community takes from the Torah and accommodate themselves with it, within it. Also, the Christian community, they take from the Bible and they accommodate their lives with it. Also, Muslims believe that the Holy Quran is the Word of God, and they take from it and accommodate their lives, all their lives. And we believe that cannot be changed, cannot be edited, cannot be touched, but it can accommodate all centuries where they are and whatever time is it, as the Bible, as the Torah. So from this point of view, we believe that to understand the Holy Quran is not easy. The Holy Quran has to come accommodate, like I said, all other religion, that has to accommodate all time, all times. So it means in every moment of our lives, there are new rules coming and new incidents happening that we can find within the Holy Quran some verses that can explain it. And that's why we believe that the Quran explains itself. One verse can explain another verse, and another verse can be explained with another verse. So you cannot take things literally. When you take things literally, you end up in confusion. You misunderstand the whole message that came to Prophet be upon him. So for such reason, we believe and we understand that from a scholarly opinion that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, has already explained the Holy Quran in cases where it is important to be explained to the to Muslims. Like for example, in Islam we have prayers, 5 prayers a day. But the way how to pray, it is not mentioned in Holy Quran. So Prophet explained it, how to pray in his holy hadith, in his holy sayings. So he explained what the Quran said in general, he gave it, he explained it part by part, and that's how the Muslims are praying. Similarly, pilgrimage, which is one of the pillars of Islam, Prophet explained it. Similarly, fasting in Ramadan, which is going to come on Monday or whatever, Tuesday or Sunday, whatever it is, this month. So Prophet explained how to fast, charity, how to pay taxes to the community, to the government. So all these has been explained by Prophet, or some of them they've been explained by the Holy Quran itself. It explained verses, explained the other verses. So if we don't have this broad picture, it's very difficult to understand any fatwa. And that's why I was surprised yesterday, that I got a fatwa from Egypt, not on this issue, but on another issue, which I was surprised by the Grand Mufti of Egypt, Ali Jum'a, he's a very good friend of us, that he said it for the first time, that ex-president Hosni Mubarak did not allow this fatwa for 40 years to come out, or 30 years to come out. The regime there didn't allow it to come out because it might not help them in their government. So they stopped it. So he released it. Yesterday it was released. So that made a big change, and it brought the two communities that they are fighting with each other all the time, the Shia community and the Sunni community, brought them together in a very nice fatwa, which in the time of President Mubarak was not allowed. So similarly, many cases on issue of terrorism or blowing themselves out, we stood many times and we said it is not accepted in Islam, as previously Dr. Tahir al-Qadri has issued a fatwa on that. And was also the same problem in the Middle East countries, which where they were not allowing their scholars to give fatwa on that. So this is why we have problems to bring up a fatwa, because you don't know the reaction of the scholars of the Muslim community. But as this problem is increasing and increasing, and I am hearing, like Sister Ifana was saying, that it's too many cases on this issue, I am also meeting with people because they ask questions and they want answers, that there are a lot of that problem, that is this violence. And I remember that big victims 2 years ago, I think, or 1 year and a half ago, years ago, before when we were putting the fatwa, someone cut the neck of his wife and chopped her head, and it was everywhere in the news. So I don't understand from where they are bringing this literary meaning of beating. So if we look into Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is our role model and the leader and the messenger of the seals of messengers, the last messenger, how much he spoke about love, mercy, compassion, and how much he was urging the community to love each other and urging the wife and husband to love each other. Depending on many verses of Holy Quran that he has mentioned, and the Holy Quran mentioned many verses on this, on how God has created the people together from one soul, as Dr. Humaira was saying, and he was urging people to cover the mistake of each other by one verse which is very important. I will quote it here. I will skip many verses, but I quote this one. هُنَّ لِبَاسٌ لَكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لِبَاسٌ لَهُنَّ. They are raiment for you and you are raiment for them. Means you are, libas is a dress. So you are a dress for them and they are a dress for you. Means you cover, when you wear your dress, you like to wear it the nicest way. Not, I don't believe anyone comes here with something that is not nice on him, to show himself he's nice, to say, that's why I am wearing this. And I have also here, pocket this also. So, to make it to look, to feel nice. So, you cover, means you have to cover each other. And God, that is from Holy Quran, verse Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah 2187, that to show us that, oh, you believe in Holy Quran as the message of God, then you make sure you are covered for your wife and she is covered for you. So if God is asking us to cover our defects and our mistakes from both sides, how we dare to take a stick or to take anything with our hand and try to beat the other? No, beat yourself first. Don't beat the other. It is said, Afdalul Jihad, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Afdalul Jihad, Kalimatu Adil, Kalimatu Haq, and the Sultan in Jair. The best of struggle, the word of justice, the word of reasoning, the word of truth against a tyrant emperor or a tyrant king. Who is the tyrant king? It's yourself. So before you raise the stick, you remember that you are tyrant with your characters. So before you beat others, beat yourself. And this is one of the main rules of Sufism, of spirituality. If we don't want to say tasawwuf or Sufism, we can say spirituality, is حاسب نفسك قبل أن تحاسب. Account, make an account for yourself before you will be accounted. So don't raise your hand on a poor lady that God has prohibited that. And they, but they say, oh, it is mentioned in Holy Quran. Okay, we are coming to that. But Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never allowed someone with his not a stick to raise his hand against a woman or against a man. It's not accepted and it is not allowed. So how our Prophet is the role model will tell us, don't beat or don't hit, and we are going and taking sticks and or taking and slapping them. From where we are bringing these excuses for ourselves? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I have been sent to perfect your characters, your behaviors. So I don't want to see my followers to have bad characters. So if Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is sending us these messages of to be merciful within the community, how we are allowing ourselves to accept, to beat. If the Holy Quran, which is literally daraba, beating, yes, it is like that, then if Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have understood it the same way, he would have ordered people to beat their wives. But Prophet never ordered and never raised his hand against his wives. So that's why there are many evidences that does not allow us to raise our hands or raise our stick at our wives. And he said, وَلَا تَنْسَوُ الْفَضْلَ بَيْنَكُمْ. And forget not kindness among yourself, man and woman. So how you are going after you are being a family, you are being in a state of love, in a state of compassion, in a state in making love and going and beating. How? And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, it's not a lady is not an animal that you beat in the morning and then in the evening you go and sleep with. So that's why, unfortunately, the behavior of some men is so strong that they are so violent that they don't want to change and to put fatwa on this issue. That's why no one has put fatwa on this issue, because they are worried to touch on it, because many would not allow them from Muslim countries, rulers or judges that they are in Muslim countries, to touch on that issue. Now, how many, and I thought that Dr. Humaira is going to touch on this, but she didn't. So one of the most one of the great scholars that the some Muslim accept him as a big scholar, and let us say he is one of the main scholar, and he is more literary than the other, where they use interpretations to different meanings of the verses of Holy Quran. He is more literary, and we call them the group of the Salafi, a kind of understanding of scholars. Sayyid Qutb, who put a fi zilal al-Quran, an explanation, a explanation of the Holy Quran. He said, and I am quoting him. They might some Sunni Muslim, they will say, why you are quoting him? I am quoting him because he is of the other kind of people, how they think, the other different groups. He said, let us go over what we have clarified earlier in terms of the honor which Allah bestowed on both aspects, male and female, of the human being. And in terms of a woman's right, which stems from her human character, and in terms of the Muslim woman retaining her civic personality along with all the rights which come with it. The right to choose her partner in life, the right to manage her own affairs, and the right to manage her own money, etc., etc., etc. It is in no way a battle between man and woman. These methods are meant to crush the head of a woman who starts to deviate in order to put her back in chains like you would do with a wild animal. This is absolutely not Islam. And he is very literary scholar, and he understands literally the meaning of Daraba, and with that he said no way to beat or no way to hit. It's not accepted in Islam. These are cultural practices which pertain to certain regions and which took place during certain ages, when not just one aspect of the human being was degraded, but the whole human being became morally degraded under the control of lust. Sayyid Qutb fi Dhilal al-Quran, in tafsir of the ayah of Daraba. So we see that even Sayyid Qutb, with a lot of respect to his scholarly opinion, he put something that we are calling for, to understand the meaning of Daraba, not to take it only literally, and he didn't take it literally. So that's why it is for us to say that in Holy Quran there is 58 verses use the word Daraba in different meanings. In one meaning, and I'm not going to count to say all of them, but many of them, this word beat, this word also has many other meanings. For example, the same verb can be translated as to tap, x, to mingle, to separate, oscillate, to fly, to incline towards, to throb, to multiply, to play music, to move, to go for a walk, to migrate, to settle down, dwell. And to quote a wise saying among others, the root of the word gives big meanings. So, like for example, you have a cup of water and you take one small grain of salt. For example, or sugar, let us not say salt, a sugar, a small grain of sugar, and you put it in that water. Does any more the water has the taste of sugar? No. It's diluted completely, disappear, because it's one grain of sugar in one big cup of water. It's completely diluted. So that meaning of Daraba, that everyone now thinks that it is beating, between 58 different meanings, means it is already diluted. And that's why we must not, as scholars, think too much about Daraba as beating, but we can think too much about Daraba as the other meaning that I have mentioned. And as I said, 58 places it has been mentioned in different meanings. Allah said, كَذَلِكَ يَضْرِبُ اللَّهُ الْحَقَّ وَالْبَاطِلِ, which means, thus Allah coins the similitude of the true and the false. Coins to coins is one meaning of Daraba. So I'm giving one example. We don't want to give many examples. So every verse of Holy Quran used Daraba, it has used a different meaning. And then if we look at Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, where many places he said that وإن خفتم شقاق بينهما فبعثوا حكما من أهله وحكما من أهله من أهلها. And if ye fear a breach between them twain, the man and wife, appoint an arbiter from his folk and an arbiter from her folk in order to make peace. He never said beat, but make peace. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خيركم خيركم لأهله وأنا خيركم لأهلي. He said the best of you is the best of to his family. Even the family is wrong. Even his wife was wrong, for example. If you want to listen what Prophet said, he said the best of you is the best to his family. And I am the best among you to my family. Means when he said I am the best among you, means he never shouted at his wife or beat his wife or slapped his wife or anything. Because he said I am the best between you to my family. So he is guiding us and directing us to be in the best way. And we are saying, no, we want to go and beat. I don't understand how the Muslim, some Muslim, I don't say all Muslim, but some Muslim, why they are thinking that they have to beat. They know that Prophet prohibited, and when they know the Holy Quran mentioned that beating 58 times. And then he said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تضربوا إماء الله. He said never beat the handmaidens of God. Never beat, never. Means no way. Give an excuse. I explain the Holy Quran. You cannot explain the Holy Quran. I am the one that can explain the Holy Quran. I explained for you how to pray. I explained for you how to fast. The Holy Quran mentioned it, fast or pray, but it didn't mention everything in particular. Holy Quran mentioned you have to pay tax to the government. He didn't say how much. Prophet said 2.5%. So this, we have to follow what Prophet has explained of what the Holy Quran has mentioned. And that's why you cannot going over the limits. وعن عائشة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أما يستحي أحدكم أن يضرب امرأته. He said, are you not ashamed to beat your wives? Means beating wives was before, and it was more than beating. We know in Islamic history they used to, if they get a girl child, they used to bury her alive. Because they don't want, they are ashamed and don't want girls. But I don't know how then they want to have generations after generations. They eliminated all ladies. So Islam came and prohibited that. So there were many things they were doing at that time. Beating, killing, and Prophet came with Holy Quran, polishing back and putting back law and Islamic law in order that they can control the manners and behaviors of the Muslims and the other communities that they were living there. And I will mention one more. عن أبي إمامة أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said, وهب لعلي غلام فقال لا تضربه فإني نهيت عن ضرب أهل الصلاة. The Prophet sent to Ali someone, a helper, and he said to him, don't beat him, for indeed I have been prohibited from beating people. Don't beat. So, not only beating women, this beating a man. Because they were, in that time, they were beating everyone. Might be they don't find anyone, they beat their animals. So Islam came and slowly cut it down, and Quran used it in 58 places, in Holy Quran in order to reduce the power of the meaning of the word. May God bless you. I will leave the time for Irfana and Dr. Hamaira. And the technicality of it is full here in this book. You can read it, and if you have questions, the floor is open for you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Irfana, Dr. Ziad, Sheikh Kabani.